Hi guys, I'm Fumela Baranda, your guide to the urban jungle. For the past 3 months, we've roamed around and beyond the metro for some of the best finds, and today, we're rounding them off for you. So sit back, relax, and join me as we give you the best of cityscape. This season, we have had chats with some of the biggest names in fashion and the arts, ogling fantastic works of art, sneaking peeks at gorgeous clothes, and being enthralled by masterful performances. Here they are. We first caught up with Spanish-born artist Betsy Westendorp, who is well known in the Philippine art scene for her beautiful portraits of prominent figures, not just in the country, but in Europe as well. She recently celebrated over 40 years of artistry with an exhibit entitled Portrait of an Artist, showcasing a glimpse into Betsy's life via her intimate family portraits, which hung alongside paintings of several well-known personalities in high society.
As long as there is beauty in the subject, I like to paint it. I am not a painter that is protested from to show the ugliness of life and the dark part of life, because I think what we need is to cheer up and to have faith and look for the beauty in things and the good part of things.
Also on display were Betsy's atmosferografias, colorful and dramatic paintings of the Manila Bay sunset, all inspired by the view from her old residence in Manila. Also on our list is national artist Carlos Botong Francisco, whose works were displayed at the Ayala Museum. The exhibit, A Nation Imagined, showcased over 40 of Botong's pieces that presented different traditions, colorful history, and the simple everyday life in his native town of Angono, Rizal. And as a bonus, acclaimed director Peke Galiaga also created a short documentary that featured some of the national artists' works of art as an homage to the artists' contributions in the film industry. We also got to chat with celebrated fashion designer Rahul Laurel about his summer offering, the Mali Collection.
We fuse the sensibility of these African prints and strength and color mixed with the 1970s vibe, that decade of ease. And then to round it all up, we wanted to add a bit of the Scandinavian silhouette, which is very clean and simple and pared down. Is characterized with lots of color, very vibrant hues of sunny yellows, brilliant emerald greens, aquas, and punctuated by lots of happy prints.
Whether in his own line or in his frequent collaborations with social enterprise R2R, Rahul's aesthetic and passion for the craft shines through. When Tony Award-winning play Red made its Asian debut, we got to talk to theater icon Bart Gingona, who both acted and directed the production.
There's a line in the play when he says, "Black is the opposite of red, not in the spectrum, but in reality. Because red is the symbol for life. It's the most the vibrant color, and black is the absence of any color. So it talks about passion, it talks about life.
Aside from red, we were also mesmerized by TV host singer Nikki Hill's performance in the restaging of the hit musical They're Playing Our Song. We last saw Nikki in the musical Sweet Charity, where her commanding presence and sweet vocals managed to hook us in. And in They're Playing Our Song, she's just as effervescent as lyricist Sonia Walsh. Meanwhile, another enthralling performer kept theater lovers at the edge of their seats in CCP. Tanghalang Pilipino managed to snag Miss Saigon alumna Janine Desiderio for its staging of the epic tale of Ibalong. Janine brought to life the half-human, half-serpent Oriol, who seduces the warrior Han Gyong and falls in love with him in the process. With brilliant acting from D-season theater vets and directions from acclaimed director Tox Rutacchio, it was an audiovisual feast that celebrated the uniqueness of Filipino culture and heritage. From the stage, we move to the silver screen where the hunky Robin Padilla built his career as the bad boy of the Philippine cinema. Over the years, he has evolved to become a more versatile actor, dabbling in romantic films as well as comedy sitcoms and even doing a bit of hosting. And now, he's become the poster boy for health and fitness. Of course, no workout is effective without proper nutrition. And Robin swears by one superfood in particular, oatmeal. But beyond fitness and nutrition, he shares this one secret that allows him to stay fit, young, and healthy.
Maging masaya ka. Alam nyo, lahat ng klase ng workout, magiging baliwala yan pag malungkot ka sa buhay mo. Kailangan light lang tayo, lahat ng dumadating sa'yo. Cool lang. Huwag ka lang masyadong mag-set ng mga goal na alam mo namang hindi mo kaya nga abutin kasi minsan ang failure, ang lakas magbigay ng depression na. Ano lang, sabi nga nila, live by the day. Kung ano yung araw na to, doon ka lang muna mabuhay.
Robin Padilla has indeed come a long way from being the country's favorite bad boy to become an inspiration to many Filipinos in more ways than one. After the break, some activities you can do over the weekend. That's coming right up, so don't go. Welcome back to Cityscape. We've always given you options on what you can do over the weekend, whether it be shopping, getting fit and healthy, or going out of town for a day adventure. This season, we gave you all that. And here's a look back on the things we did and actually enjoyed. The oriental area of Manila, Binondo, offers an experience to anyone who wants to explore the vibrant culture of China. The first order of business for anyone who is in Binondo is to experience a proper Chinese laureate. Here, they serve up dishes from all over China, so there's bound to be a few surprises in store for you, like this mantis rice, an interesting dish that is new to many. So Ivan, this is what a typical Chinese laureate looks like.
Yes, traditionally laureates came in 12 dishes and bigger portions, bigger sizes. In fact, if you look at the history of the word laureate in English.
Oh yeah, I want to know where laureate came from.
It came from the Hokkien Chinese word laudiat. Laudiat means loud and happy.
Ooh.
So from that alone, loud and happy, it's a festive occasion.
Laudiat.
And we have some dishes here which are very symbolic for a lot of Chinois. This one, it's called cha mi sua.
But mi sua is it also symbolizes something.
Well, noodles in general is a happy food. You know, when it's birthday, it's New Year, you want to eat noodles because it symbolizes long life.
Long life. No?
For the Cantonese, Chinese, no? Well, you know, shrimps, they jump.
Yeah.
No? So jumping shrimps, supposedly, according to them, symbolizes like, you know, going up.
Yeah.
Or maybe improvement, you know, in life or whatever.
Okay, so you have to eat a lot of shrimp for New Year.
Well, not even just New Year. I like shrimps.
Yes. Shrimp, as it is very, very good.
After enjoying a sumptuous meal, you can walk around the streets of Binondo to shop. One iconic area is the Carvajal Street. Here, a wide selection of fruits and Chinese delicacies can be bought. A little insider tip for you. Shopkeepers in Binondo are very friendly, so go ahead and get a little chummy with them, because sometimes they'll let you help yourself to a sampling of their fares while you're deciding what to buy. Next stop on our food tour is a short snack break at Awi's, a little hole-in-the-wall resto that's quickly gaining popularity. And to cap off our tour, a final stop in Holland for some Chinese goodies to bring home. A day in Binondo is not enough to fully grasp what China has to offer, but it's a good experience for anyone who wants to try something different in the metro. And along the way, you can learn a thing or two about the Chinese culture. But if you're up for doing something more adventurous, wakeboarding at Republic Wake Park can satisfy your adrenaline rush. The Wake Park is not a conventional water sport activity in the Philippines, but over the years, it has been getting a lot of buzz for its stimulating experience. Republic Wake Park is littered with obstacles worthy of pro boarders, and they do come from all over the world just to try it out. Like any other sport, you need to learn first some safety pointers before you can fully enjoy it. And after a couple of minutes of briefing and crash course lessons, you're good to go. The Wake Park is just a couple of hours drive away from the city. So if you want to try some water sports this weekend, this is a good option for you. If you don't have the luxury of time to go on a walking tour or enjoy a day in a Wake Park, CrossFit training might just be the perfect alternative for you. Here, you can join their workout of the day classes with other fitness enthusiasts. The class starts with a short orientation, some warm-ups, and a hands-on demo on the different stages of the workout.
A whole session of CrossFit lasts for an entire hour. Some of our workouts can last between 3 minutes to maybe 30 minutes at the longest, and we always incorporate different domains, as we'd like to call them, of different sports meets.
The metabolic conditioning or METCON starts with some cleans or weightlifting, and then the ring rows. While some students prefer doing this particular exercise, others find the pull-up exercise more fitting to them. CrossFit offers a high-intensity, fast-paced workout that can give you an instant muscle burn, a perfect way to stay fit and healthy. A gastronomic trip when we return, as we give your top food picks this season. Cityscape will be right back. You're still watching Cityscape and more of the best in the metro. Here on the show, we're always on the lookout for the tastiest fares, and this season's gastronomic journey is no exception, as we sampled mouth-watering dishes from old-time favorites and newly opened restaurants. Here are our top picks. Chateau 1771 has been known to foodies for its unique brand of No Borders cuisine. And for its 25th anniversary, the restaurant rolled out a menu that tickled our palates. The appetizers were simply, what else, appetizing.
This is their goat cheese and grilled apple salad, and I'm going to pair it up with an old-time favorite, some melted raclette cheese. Yummy.
One thing that caught my attention is the vanilla brick chicken.
It's a spring organic chicken, which we serve table side. So we do a lot of table side service because it's a dying art, so I wanted to put it back. It's quite unique to have vanilla beans spread on chicken skin, and then it's like crisp fried under a brick. It also goes with this sauce, like brown sauce, which I deglaze with a little Bacardi rum.
An oldie but definite goodie was the potans, grilled beef tenderloin hung on a metal gallows and flambéed with some coconut brandy, and served with some garlic sauce, Café de Paris butter, and of course, some gravy. The first-rate dishes and inviting atmosphere of Chateau 1771 make for an amazing dining experience. For some nostalgia-inducing Filipino fares, we headed on over to M Cafe's next-door neighbor, Kabila. One thing I can say about Kabila and M Cafe's interiors is that each is distinct. But with the use of muted palettes and interesting fixtures, both designs blend seamlessly. And the openness of the space lets you cross over to the original M Cafe. I'm about to try some of Kabila's appetizers. I'll start off with the Davao's Malagos cheese platter. This queso gustico is their version of the Parmesan cheese. When dining, interesting to note here was the smartly named empanada, stuffed with vegan longanisa, among other surprises. Wow, I've got a lot of eating to do, so I'm gonna dig right in. There's a lot of dishes in front of me, but I'm excited to try it. I'll start off with the gindara, the grilled gindara. Teriyaki sauce is so good. Kabila's cocktails also carry a patriotic twist. The gin pompi is reminiscent of the much-loved Pinoy drink with a cucumber twist. Kabila is both nostalgic and new for Pinoy cuisine-loving foodies. There's enough of the familiar to lure those looking for home-style cooking, with a dash of new flavors mixed in to intrigue those craving for a more adventurous form of gastronomy. Moving on to one of Pinoy's favorite Southeast Asian cuisines, Thai. Our latest discovery was Koh Samui. The Thai dishes here come from the southern region of Thailand, a little bit sweet and healthier as compared to the northern region counterpart. Start your meal here with a three fortune platter, which is composed of fopia, chicken pandan, and Spanish mackerel fish cakes. Other must-tries include the deep-fried fish shrimp cake, as well as the chicken feet salad. And for soups, the Tom Yam Goong is your best bet. It has just the right amount of kick to it, and as expected, it's a real crowd pleaser. For the main course, I recommend the rich golden curry crab. The yellow curry crab is so flavorful that it's best to have it with plain rice. There's also the very popular and photogenic pineapple rice. And the grilled charcoal chicken. The food at Koh Samui is quintessentially